Last week, religion and women, we covered half of that. The idea of discussing specifically religion and women is something actually historical, because in a way we can say that there is no need to discuss religion and women in particular, because all there are in human society is men and women. So, you know, why do we have to specially discuss women and religion? Now, the main reason is, in fact, when you look at world religions, in the world religions, you can see that the religions were started by men. The religious teachers are basically men. And not simply because of that, if you look at the religious organizations, usually these religious organizations are represented by men. So either as basically as religious monks or as custodians of religion. So in either way, you can see that religions are basically represented by men. So in such a situation, historically, we can see that, you know, there have been many issues associated with this thing. Particularly interesting thing is how women have been represented in the religions. Okay, now when you look at both Eastern and Western religions, this is one particular thing that, you know, all these religions agree with. You know, they all agree to keep women in the lower position. And what is the reason of this? Okay, we will need to discuss this also in connection with Buddhism, which I will do towards the end of today's discussion, and then we will try to conclude this. So in our last week discussion, we looked at basically the feminist movements, how feminists are trying to establish rights of women, and certain particular feminist concerns that encourage, you know, this modern day discussion on women and religion. Then we looked at Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism. Okay, from that we will move into today the Abrahamic religions. You know what Abrahamic religions are. We had an earlier discussion on this. Abrahamic religions share the male-dominated character in religion and subordination of women. Subordination of women means women to be under men. So that is the subordination of women. Both Judaism and Christianity share Torah, which is called the Old Testament by Christians. According to Genesis, God created man, and thinking that it is not good for man to be alone, created woman from man. The idea of subordination of women, woman to man, is found in this story itself. Now, you know, this creation story is interesting. According to this creation story, it is God created man first. He did not have an idea of creating a woman, so he created man according to this story. So seeing that man was alone, in order to keep company, he created woman. You know, that is the basic story. Now if you look at this story very carefully, you can see that story itself contains certain elements, certain things that make women subordinate to men. Like God created man first. So woman is not in that original plan then. So the woman is what we say afterthought. We say usual parlance, afterthought. Something not thought originally, but you know, something that comes to your mind later. So the woman is a result of a afterthought of God. It is not that God started thinking that, okay, I will create man and woman. He just created man. Then only it came to his mind that he should create somebody to keep company with. Now the second thing is, so the story says that God created woman to keep company with man. So in order to keep company or to help. So again, you can see that in the story, there is a subordinate position of women. So this story in the Genesis, God creating woman, but creating woman later, after thinking that it is not good for man to be alone. So, you know, that very story, you know, these stories are very powerful. These stories have been told to people for thousands of years. So, you know, woman, the men's attitude towards women, you know, shape accordingly. Now, if you take the Buddhist description in the Aggaña Sutta, now, as you know, Buddhism doesn't talk about the absolute beginning of the world, right? It talks about different stages of evolving, sangvatta, sangvattamana, vivatta, vivattamana. So, now, during the sangvatta period, all those people who lived in here, last people, go to Abhasara world. And then again in the vivattamana period, they come back. Now, there is no gender. Whether they are men or women, there is no. But then what happens is their gender is decided according to their previous birth. Those people who were men become men. Those people who were women become women. Okay? So that story, you know, it is a story, it's true. But you know, whether the way it has been put is the Buddhist story is that how men and women were born into the world, the men and women who were men before, because this is not the absolute beginning. So men who were men before become men, and women who were become women before, they become women. But in the Christian story is different, because Christian story is absolute beginning. So at the absolute beginning, God creates man first, and then subsequently God creates woman. So, you know, these are the, you know, the basic differences. But the biblical story is a good indication of the subordination of woman. You know, woman is kind of kept as an assistant to the man, you know, something like that. In the traditional Christianity, women are not allowed to teach or preach in public assembly, which was a part of man's authority. In Roman Catholicism, Eastern and Oriental Orthodox churches, women cannot be priests or deacons. Now, if you look at the Christian religion, you have Roman Catholicism, Eastern Orthodox, Oriental Orthodox, you know, these are the certain, and then also Protestant churches. Now, in Roman Catholicism, usually in these religious traditions, women are not allowed to teach. They can't preach in public assembly, which was a part of man's authority. So teaching and preaching was considered to be the man's work, the male priest's work. So therefore, the women were prohibited from that. So women can't become a teacher. Women can't become a public preacher. Now they preach in the church, so church preaching is basically done by the man, not by woman. So this is the Christian position. And not only that, in Roman Catholicism, Eastern and Oriental Orthodox churches, women cannot be priests or deacons. Women can't be a priest. Now in the Christian tradition, a priest means a priest gets God authority, ordained. We use the word ordain. Ordaining means really receiving the authority. Now in English language, sometimes we use the same term to ordination or ordaining for the monks. But actually that doesn't make sense, because you know, you are not getting any divine authority when you become a bhikkhu. So this English word, although we have to use English language, we are using that term. But if you look at the real meaning of the term, Buddhist monks cannot be ordained. Okay? Because ordination or ordain mean you get the divine authority. Now this divine authority vested only in man. So the Christian priest can pardon your sins because of that divine authority. But you know, usually women are not allowed to that. But more recently in the Protestant churches, now there are women have been appointed to be priest. But not in Roman Catholic, Eastern Orthodox, or Oriental Orthodox churches. So Protestant churches, as I discussed with you the other day, it started in the 16th century with Martin Luther. So, you know, so some Protestant churches have women as priest. But Roman Catholic churches, they don't have women as priests. You know, so this is the basically the difference. We'll go to Islam. In Islam, although women are totally subordinated to men, Sharia law affirms the women's right to marriage, divorce, and inheritance. This is considered to be an improvement on the practices prevalent in the society in which Islam originated in the 7th century Common Era. Now, you know, Islam, when you look at the Islamic religion today, we can see that the women are totally subordinated. And also women get, as I said the other day, many more restrictions. For example, when women go out, you know, they're supposed to cover their heads. But you know, in very Orthodox societies, even in other places you can see, they not only they cover the entire face, and in front of their eyes they have some kind of net. So they see through only that net. You know, it is a public the behavior, you know, their behavior outside this, you know, restricting women so much. The idea is that the women are the source of evil. So if men see women, they go upset or something like that. So in order to protect, actually it is not to protect women, it is to protect men from women. They cover women, okay? So, you know, it's a very strange idea. It is not to protect women, really. The idea is to protect because men get, you know, the confusion in their mind. So then, so you better, you know, the completely. So in some places they cover up to here, some places they cover up to the head, and some places they cover except eyes. In some places they even cover eyes. So, you know, you don't see anything at all of these people. Now, these are, you know, the kind of social restrictions you can see. But important thing is in the 7th century Common Era, when Islamic religion was started, they started their what is called the Sharia law. Sharia law means the divine law, the religious law. Now, according to that law, marriage, divorce, and inheritance, these three are women have right. Women have right means women can marry a person she likes. And then divorce. She can, for reasons, divorce the man. And then inheritance means she can own. Okay. Now, you know, these things were considered to be improvements. Now, if you look at carefully, you know, sometimes European tradition, Western tradition was not developed during that period up to this point. Actually, in the, you know, some of the Western tradition, Western countries, women could even get a credit card only about 30 to 40 years ago. Up to that point, they can't even get a credit card. They can't own a business. They don't have inheritance in the Western America and England, you know, other countries. So, you know, if you look at it from that point of view, you can see that Islamic law was much progressive. So the woman can own her property, woman can divorce, and then woman can marry. But the interesting thing is, although the law says this, but in the practice, how it was practiced is, you know, the problematic. Because in these societies, the practice has been problematic. Now, some people want to say that, look, religion is really great, but, you know, only because of, you know, the cultural practices of different countries and different societies are the ones that restrict women. But, you know, the religious organization condone these things. Now, for example, divorce. Technically, in Sharia law, a woman can divorce a man. But, you know, man can divorce a woman much easier. You know, they have this word called talat. You can just say three times that word. That's all. The woman is divorced. You say that word three times. You know, the woman is considered to be divorced. Now, you know that in the usual civil law, if you want to divorce a man or woman, you know, it is a legal process. Very often, legal process is not very easy. It takes time. But in the Islamic tradition, it is a matter of man saying that word three times in front of your woman, and, you know, marriage is dissolved. But woman cannot that easily divorce. But anyhow, these three things. So this is considered to be an improvement. When Islamic society, Islamic religion was started in the Middle East area, women were in an extremely, the unfortunate situation. Now, judging from that, these three laws are really improvement, okay? But the interesting thing is, you know, ever since how the Islamic society behaved towards women is the important thing. But anyhow, for the time being, we will go with this. So the affirms the woman's right to marriage, divorce and inheritance. Okay. The scholars try to make a distinction between Sharia law and the cultural practices in different countries. The currently seen discriminations against women are attributed to such cultural differences. However, not all are due to cultural differences. It is usually men who interpret Quran and the laws. Now, you know, the Sharia law, Sharia means the divine law. But the divine law is in the book. And then Islamic people have a very elaborate tradition of interpreting the law. I mean, you have the law in the Quran. But then how to interpret it, how to apply it, usually done by not by women, but by men. Okay? So the interpretation of law is basically up to men. In other words, it is men who interpret the law. Okay? So on the one hand, we see that scholars say that Sharia law is one, but the cultural practices are another. So therefore, the conflict is between the Sharia law and the cultural practices. And they say that whatever the behaviors we see today, they attribute these things into cultural practices. But the interesting thing is, you know, when you look at a religion as a form of book and religion as a form of practice, you can see that here there is a big difference. For example, in many Islamic countries, women are not allowed to study, really. They don't send to school. I remember, for example, I went to Pakistan one time. We traveled in that country about 2 weeks. You never see girls going to school. In that country, you only see girls just about 10 years old or below that. Any girl who is attained puberty, that means the young or adult girl, you don't see them because they are kept inside the houses. And the houses are built in such a way that entrance door you have about 8 feet wall. So they don't see outside. Nobody else can see the inside. They are kept inside and they are not sent in school. Now, if you go to any other country, if you go to Sri Lanka, by about 1:15, schools closed. You know, you can't walk or go in a car in the road. There are so many thousands of girls and boys on the road. Now, again, just around 7:30, you know, children are going to school. So you can see that practically millions of girls and boys go to school in these countries. But But in the Islamic countries, you don't have women going to school. So, you know, they don't get the education. Not every country, but, you know, there are other countries now, you know, they allow. But, you know, Afghanistan, Pakistan, you know, most of these countries, you know, they don't allow women to get any education. So, you know, women grow up as without education, and so they can't have much to think. You know, so in the Islamic societies, women are ultimately put into the position, you only bear in children. Okay? So you can see that, you know, the Sharia law can be saying one, practices can be different. Even within Sharia law, you can see that women are highly, you know, the restricted. So the currently seen discriminations against women are attributed to such cultural differences. However, not all are due to cultural differences. It is usually men who interpret the Quran and the laws. So you can't say everything is because of cultural differences, because even those things they justify based on Quran. Anyhow, it is up to the men to decide the fate of women. So it is not that women are capable of interpreting the Sharia law. In Islam, men and women cannot pray together. Now, in the mosque, the men and women can't be praying together. They are separated. Women are not permitted to pray during their menstruation, labor, and pregnancy. And particularly, you know, the women are not allowed to pray in their menstruation or when they are pregnant or when their labor means in the process of giving birth to children, right after giving birth to children. You know, in these occasions, so, you know, this idea of physical uncleanliness, you know, that's again is, you know, supported by different religions. Now, Islamic religion, of course, supports that. To my knowledge, in Christianity, Roman Catholicism or Judaism, I don't know really, but in Roman Catholic religion, Christianity, you don't have this discrimination, you know, on the ground that, you know, women are not clean at menstruation and, you know, things like that. But basically, you can see Islamic thinking also has that. Polygamy, which was rampant in the pre-Islamic society, polygamy means having more than one woman, was limited to four women under Islam. So, you know, we know that under Islam, a man can marry four women, okay, up to four. This too is provided that the husband has means to treat all his wives equally. Like, you know, the man can marry up to four women, provided that that man can, you know, the treat each woman equally. Like you buy a cloth for one woman, you have to buy cloth for all four women or something like that. You know, I mean, you treat all four women equally. If you can treat all equally, you can marry up to four. Now, today we see that, you know, it is really a violation of human rights of women. But by the time the Islamic religion started, men could marry any number of women. So actually, in that sense, Islamic religion restricted it into four. Okay? So in other words, from the point of view of that time, Islamic religion was an improvement, because men could marry any number of women. So Islamic stopped that, restricted that into up to four. Okay? Even that up to four, if the man is economically capable of, you know, the providing in the equal manner. So in that sense, you can see that it's a, you know, the improvement. But in today's the ideas, we know that, you know, the any man getting into, you know, the four different wives, you know, is not acceptable in many societies. Islamic societies, men and women are not equal before the law. Women are treated in much harsher manner for sexual offenses such as adultery. Now, you know, another interesting thing is usually in the modern world, everybody is considered equal before law. You know, this very well-known symbol of justice, the woman holding the scales, blindfolded. The idea of blindfolded means the justice doesn't see anything. Justice doesn't see whether you are man or woman, you are higher or lower, you are black or white, justice doesn't see any of these things. That is signified by, you know, blindfolded lady. But in the Islamic society again, men and women are not equal before the law. You know, for the same crime, men can be punished in one manner, women can be punished in a different manner. For example, in many Islamic societies, if a woman found guilty with sexual offense, the woman is killed. In some societies, even today, they kill the woman by stoning. Okay? Now, this killing somebody by stoning is a very brutal way of killing. But that way of killing had been in ancient areas where Christianity and Islam originated, like Middle Eastern countries. In fact, even in the Bible, there is a story that Jesus connected with Jesus. When one day Jesus was going, he saw that a group of men were ready to stone a woman. Then Jesus says, okay, the first one to stone should be the one who has not done anything wrong. Then, you know, everybody gets, you know, confused, because all the men have sinned, done wrong things. Having done wrong things themselves, how can they really stone a woman who has done something wrong? So Jesus says, okay, first one to stone should be the one who has not done anything wrong. So no one was like that. Everybody, one, you know, had sinned in some way or other. You know, the story shows that, you know, the stoning to death is existing in that society for a long time. And in Islamic societies, they still continue with that. In Islamic societies, not all, in some societies, they still continue with that. And also beheading. You just chop off the head. So, you know, these things are, you know, quite common. So, the larger issue is that Islamic societies, men and women are not equal before the law. So, which means that for the same offense, man gets much lighter, simpler punishment. The woman gets much harsher punishment. So, which shows that, you know, they are not. Particularly for the sexual offenses. We never hear men being punished for sexual offenses in these societies. But we hear quite a lot even today, women being punished for the sexual offenses. Okay? Education for women is either highly restricted or prohibited in many Islamic societies even today. This has enabled many such societies to keep women ignorant and under the authority of men. Now, another important consequence of lack of education is when women don't have education, they become very ignorant, narrow-minded, cannot think. You know, then it is very easy for them to keep people under their control. In many places in the world, you know that when the dictators rule, they don't want people to study. If society becomes a learned society, then it is very difficult to control that society. So, in many places in the world, dictators, they don't want people to go to school. They don't want people to go to university. They don't want people to get education. Because educated people can think. They can question. So, they don't want. Now, that is happening in many Islamic societies. They don't teach women. So that way women don't question anything. They just accept, they have to accept everything. They are ignorant. You know, they don't know what is going on. So, you know, this is the situation with education. So you can see that in Islamic societies, education and the law and the marriage and, you know, these things, how, you know, the women are treated. Now, as we noted earlier, all religions have been initiated by men, and men have formed the basic core of many religions. Consequently, the ultimate goal of religion has been articulated aiming at men. Furthermore, the religious texts of all the major religions have been written by men, and hence they are meant for men. It is for this reason that many religions, the women have been portrayed as the source of evil and sin, and hence considered the main obstacle of men who try to follow religion. The Christian story of the forbidden tree signifies this belief. If the religious texts were authored by women, this would have been different. Feminist thinkers have tried to address this issue of male centricity prevalent in religion. Now, you know, this couple of ideas that I try to express here is very important. Basically, as we noted earlier, all religions have been initiated by men, and men have formed the basic core of many religions. Consequently, ultimate goal of religion has been articulated aiming at men. Now, what it means is this. Now, if you look at the religions, now this includes Buddhism also, Buddhist literature also. But you know, in all these religious literature, women have been described as the source of evil. They are the source of danger. In other words, these religious texts portray women as the source. Women as the source of danger for man. Now, you know, this biblical story, as we saw earlier, God created man first, and then God created the woman. And then God says to these two people not to eat from that forbidden tree. Okay. According to the biblical story, it is the woman who persuaded Adam to eat this fruit. So once Adam eats the forbidden fruit, you know, he started seeing things differently. Now in this story, it is the woman who gets man to do that. So actually this story signifies that it is a woman who leads man in the wrong way, man who leads man astray. You know, this idea is again. Now you know how this idea has come. How has this idea come? It's, you know, something we need to think. Why do all religions say this? All religions say, you know, the problem is with women. I think historically, as I showed you, it is men who have started religion, and also it is the men who have written all the books on religion, right? Now, initially, basically, you can see that the religion comes to us from man's point of view, okay? So it comes from man's point of view. Now, therefore, we don't know. We don't have the woman's religious literature. Now, I will give you an example from Buddhism. Now, if you take Buddhist teaching, we have the Digha Nikaya, Majjhima Nikaya, Anguttara, Sanyutta, Sutta, and Vinaya recited at the First Council, right? First Council took place after 3 months of Parinirvana of the Buddha, 3 months. And then there were 500 monks got together to do the first Sanghayana. Okay? Now someone can ask, where are the bhikkhunis? Why no bhikkhunis for the first Sanghayana? Where are the bhikkhunis? Why only bhikkhus got together 500? No bhikkhunis, okay? Now when you look at the discourses, you can see that discourses, of course, have Therigatha, we have, and then in the Sanyutta Nikaya, Bhikkhuni Sanyutta is there. So there are some sections. But overally, if you look at the Dhamma, you can see that the emphasis is on men or the bhikkhus to achieve the Nirvana, not to bhikkhunis. Is that because Buddha did not teach anything to bhikkhunis, or is that because what the Buddha taught to bhikkhunis is not recorded? Now, what is the situation? Now, Buddha, on the one hand, started bhikkhu sasana, and then subsequently Buddha started the sasana for bhikkhunis. Now, Buddha started sasana for bhikkhunis could mean that Buddha must have taught Dhamma to the bhikkhunis. But then the question is, where is that Dhamma? Where are these discourses? Where are these discourses? what did the Buddha say to the bhikkhunis? Buddha must have said many things to the bhikkhunis, but where are they? For example, in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, there is a story. Buddha was close to attain Parinirvana, and then Venerable Ananda asked from the Buddha, how should they behave towards women? You know, Buddha, Venerable Ananda asked from the Buddha, how should they behave towards women? Then Buddha says, what does Buddha say? Adassanam Ananda. Don't look at them. Okay. And then Buddha says, if they look at them, don't talk to them. If they talk to us, be very mindful. Okay. Now this is the story. Now the important thing is this. Suppose, just for the sake of, suppose bhikkhunis ask from the Buddha, how should we behave towards monks? Then what would be the answer? Adassanam. Isn't it? Don't look at them. If they look at you, don't talk to them. If they talk to you, establish your mind. Can't it be like that? What do you think? Because we don't have that. We don't have such a discourse. So we don't know whether women ask, whether the bhikkhunis ask that same question from the Buddha. Because bhikkhus asked that question, Buddha said, don't look at them. Don't talk to them. Establish your mindfulness. But I think it is not only for the bhikkhunis. Bhikkhus, it's also applicable to the bhikkhunis. If the bhikkhuni asked the same question from the Buddha, I think Buddha would have given the same answer, isn't it?
Yes.
What do you think? Because now the story looks like, you know, only you have to be careful about women. But you know, if you really understand the teaching of the Buddha, both men and women both want to attain Nirvana. Okay? Yes. Both men and women want to attain Nirvana. Now as a man, you have your desire. You have your biggest desire for women. As a woman, you have biggest desire for men. So, you know, you have to get rid of that desire in order to attain Nirvana. Right? That is the idea. So, it is very rational that, you know, women keep away from men and men keep away from women in order to attain Nirvana. But the interesting thing is, maybe because it is only men, only Arahant who are men, did the first Sangha, you know, there is nothing that Buddha taught, nothing much. Of course, there are certain things, but not much Buddha taught to bhikkhunis, or Buddha taught about women. Now, someone can ask the question, why the nuns were, bhikkhunis were not participating in the first Sanghayana? Where were the bhikkhunis? Why were they not? Because we can say that, you know, a lot of things Buddha taught to women, we don't have. Right? Because they were not recorded. Because there were no nuns. Why no nuns? Suppose first Sanghayana had both monks and nuns together. Or suppose nuns got together separately and had their Sutra Pitaka separately. Then there will be a lot of suttas Buddha taught to Mahaprajapati Gotami. There will be a lot of suttas Buddha taught to Patachara and, you know, Kisa Gotami and, you know, Yasodhara and, you know, many other nuns. But we don't have any records of those discourses. Okay? Now, one reason is we don't know what the Buddha taught. So actually, the interesting thing is in Buddhism, if you take Buddhism, one position is we can say, no, Buddha did not talk anything about women, Buddha taught only to men. That is one position. The other position is Buddha taught women, but they have been not recorded. What do you think is the reasonable position here? Can we think that Buddha did not teach anything to bhikkhunis? Now, according to the Vinaya, there is a position called bhikkhuno vadaka, bhikkhuni o vadaka. So, you know, the monks are, senior monks are, expected to go and teach the Dhamma to bhikkhunis, right? And then in the Vinaya, there are also qualifications mentioned. Not each and everybody can go and teach the Dhamma to the nuns. There must be senior, qualified monks who can teach Dhamma to the nuns, right? So that also is there. And then Buddha must have also taught Dhamma to bhikkhunis. But the interesting thing is we don't have many records. Only thing to my knowledge is, you know, we have Bhikkhuni Sanyutta in the Sanyutta Nikaya, just a very small section. But what about the, all the other discourses Buddha must have taught? So there could be two positions. One thing is to think that, no, Buddha did not teach much to bhikkhunis. The other position is, what the Buddha taught to bhikkhunis is not recorded. Now, my personal view is, the first one is not correct. It is not correct to say that Buddha did not teach bhikkhunis. Actually, Buddha taught bhikkhunis. I think the second thing is the correct thing, because the things Buddha taught to bhikkhunis has not been recorded. Okay? I mean, the Tripitaka, we have vast amount of discourses anyway. But in spite of that, we can think that so much Buddha taught to bhikkhunis may be not recorded. Okay? Now, you know, as a result, interesting thing is, when you read the Sutta Pitaka discourses, you can see that, you know, women have been portrayed as the problem. You know, women are the problem for the men. So, you know, the Indriya Sangvara, restraint of faculties, all these things are taught with reference to women. So how the monks have to guard their senses, Indriya Sangvara, and all those things. But what I am thinking is this. I think similar things must have been there for the bhikkhunis also. Now, suppose we had a Tripitaka only written by bhikkhunis. Then, you know, it would be very different from the present day Tripitaka. Don't you think so? It could be different. Because there it could be like, oh, these men are really the source of evil. Men are really bad. Because, you know, looking from woman's point of view, and if you want to get rid of the desire for men, Buddha have to show how bad men are. But here we have only how bad women are. So that is why we say the existing Dhamma is given to us from the point of view of man. So now, from the point of view of man, not only in Buddhism, in many religions it is the case, because, you know, they considered it to be the you know, the priority of the man. So anything from that point of view, you look at the woman as the main obstacle, main problem for the person attaining you know, the religious goal. Now you look at Christianity, it is the same. You know, the women have been portrayed in a very, very negative manner. Women have been portrayed in the very negative manner. Now, why? Because men were basically the people. So the religious practice was looked from the point of view of man. So because it was looked from the point of view of man, women were the problem. Okay. Now, actually, I think through Buddhist literature, we can really see this issue very much more clearly. Okay, because you have bhikkhus and also you have bhikkhunis. Now both bhikkhus and bhikkhunis want to attain nirvana, realize nirvana. Now realize nirvana happens basically when you purify your mind, visuddhi, from lobha, dosa, moha. Now even in them, lobha or tanha considered to be the most important factor. According to Four Noble Truths, dukkha samudaya, nirodha magga. Samudaya means rising of suffering. Now, how does suffering arises? Suffering arises out of craving or desire, tanha. Okay, tanha is basically tanha for panchakama, rupa, sadda, gandha, rasa, potthabba. You know, this is the basic idea. Now, in other words, human beings suffer because of tanha. In order to get rid of suffering, we have to terminate or get rid of tanha. Now, this is the basic idea in Buddhism. Okay, this is the basic concept in Four Noble Truths. Now, it is very natural that if a man wants to attain nirvana, man has to get rid of rupa, sabda, gandha, rasa, pottabba. The kama for these five pleasurable objects. Now the same thing for women. If a woman wants to attain nirvana, she has to get rid of the kama for the rupa, sabda, gandha, rasa and pottabba. Now you know, for both men and women, this kama can be different, because when you look at the man's kama, attachment, desire, it centers around women, and the women's desire centers around man. Okay, so you know, this is a pretty basic thing. Now in the discourses we find how men should behave towards women, how men should look at women, but unfortunately we don't have a part where how women should look at men, because the tanha is same for both. Only thing is, women have tanha for certain things, men have tanha for certain other things. Okay, now if we had the discourses dealing with both, then we can see how these women and men have been characterized. But today we have discourses only about dealing with men, so talking about women. So in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, when finally Venerable Ananda asked how should we behave towards women, Buddha says, Adassaran, don't look at them. But you know, when I read this story in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, now Buddha is attaining Parinirvana. Buddha lived 45 years as the Buddha. Now do you think it is a very natural location for Venerable Ananda to ask how should they behave towards women? Now 45 years, how did they behave anyway? Now Buddha is attaining Parinirvana, isn't it? Now why did Venerable Ananda wait 45 years to ask this question? How did they behave toward women before that? Don't you see something problematic with that question? Why 45 years? How did they behave up to that point? Was it such an important question? And after all, it is Venerable Ananda who persuaded the Buddha to give Bhikkhuni Sasana, isn't he? It is Venerable Ananda who persuaded Buddha to give the Bhikkhuni Sasana. Then after all these things, Venerable Ananda asked him from the Buddha, how should we behave towards women? What do you think about this question? Anyway, you know, when you read Tripitaka also, you have to be thinking about these things, okay? That is, as you know, we have to be examining things, okay? Just think, you know, how could it be? Okay, I'm not trying to teach you how to read the Tripitaka, but for me, you know, that question becomes a little bit odd question, okay? Because on the other hand, I think that if a Bhikkhuni asks same question, what would the Buddha say? If a Bhikkhuni asks the same question, how do we behave towards men? Then, you know, if Buddha gave that answer, Adassanam Ananda, I think Buddha would have given the same answer to the Bhikkhuni. Adassanam, don't look at men. You know, so that could be. But anyhow, you know, this is something interesting for us to think, because now existing discourses, most of the discourses we see as representing Dhamma from the man's point of view. So therefore, what is described are the things that are hindrances to man to attain Nirvana. But I am sure, because Buddhism, we did not have this discrimination actually, because Buddha started Bhikkhuni Sasana. Now sometimes when we look at the story of Bhikkhuni Sasana, sometimes people think, why Buddha did not start Bhikkhuni Sasana right away? Because according to the traditional story, we are told that Buddha refused three times. Buddha refused three times. When Mahapajapati Gautami asked, Buddha said, no, no, no. You know, he said three times. And then why? Why Buddha refused three times? You know, there are many explanations. But I think there is one very, very, very relevant explanation. Now, Bhikkhusasana was already there, okay? Bhikkhusasana was already there. Now, Bhikkhunisasana means you are bringing in the, you know, the women's order, women's organization also into this, okay? Now, when you bring women's organization into it, you are bringing these women. I told you earlier, in Indian context, women were always protected in the house by father, by husband, by son. Now, you know, you bring these women out of house, home, to Buddha Sasana. Now, one question is, who is going to protect them? When they were at household, they would have been protected by their father, husband, or son. But, you know, you take them out into Sasana, who are going to protect them physically? Actually, many young and beautiful bhikkhunis were attacked, and some were raped during the time of the Buddha, because, you know, no one to protect them. Now, the problem is, can you ask the monks, bhikkhus, to protect the bhikkhunis? No, because bhikkhus also came leaving behind their wives and daughters because they want to be free. Now, having become monk, a bhikkhu, in order to be free, can you now go back and start protecting these bhikkhunis? No, that is not proper. Because they left their household life. If they wanted to be at home, safeguarding their wife and daughters or whatever, they could have been at home without becoming monks, bhikkhus. Okay? So, you know, but more than that, even more important thing is, when you start the bhikkhuni order or bringing in bhikkhunis to the sasana, you know, there is a basic, very fundamental problem there. The basic fundamental problem is the men have become bhikkhus in order to get rid of the desire. Now, women are also becoming bhikkhunis in order to get rid of that desire. How can you put these two groups together? How can you put these two groups together? Because men came from home because they could not do that at home. So they came to a different the environment. But then women also coming out of home because, you know, they wanted to have a different environment. But ultimately, you put two groups together. And we know that there were problems. Actually, after the Bhikkhunisasana started, started having problems. Some bhikkhunis started doing their usual household work, washing monks' clothes and cleaning the monks' rooms and, you know, stuff like that. So finally, the bhikkhunis started playing the same sex roles they used to play at home. So, you know, the problems started. So therefore, what I'm trying to tell you is this. On the one hand, when you look at the religions, you can see that in the religions, usually the point of view is men's point of view. Okay? Now, in Buddhism, I try to explain to you, we don't get much of the woman's point of view because, you know, the Tripitaka we have is, you know, the council recited by the monks. If we had a bhikkhunis version also, you know, we could have had, you know, some different suttas taught by the Buddha. But, you know, in the history there are no records. We don't know whether really bhikkhunis got together and had a different sanghayana or not. We don't know. But we can imagine. We can imagine that there could be some discourses that the Buddha taught Dhamma to the bhikkhunis. Naturally, Buddha would have put the more emphasis on the bhikkhunis aspect, and then they would have talked about how to avoid men in their, you know, the practice. Now we have discourses how to avoid women in the practice, but we don't have anything much about how should women behave, okay? Now, you know, this. There are some other problems also, historical problems and all these things. But basically, you know, in Buddhism. But if you take Christianity and Islam and Judaism and also Hinduism and other religions, you can see that women were really kept aside and not being included in. Now, for example, if you take Jainism, according to Jainism, a woman cannot really become a siddha. Okay? Now, according to Buddhism, of course, Buddha has not said that. In the later Buddhist tradition, there is a belief that a woman cannot become a Buddha, right? But you know, that belief is not found in the Tripitaka, but maybe it is found in the commentaries. It says that women cannot become Buddha. But in Buddhism, woman can become an Arahant. Okay? Now, actually the difference between Buddha and Arahant is in a sense, I'm not saying Buddha and Arahant are the same, but Buddha is also an Arahant. Okay? Buddha is also an Arahant. We must not forget that. We start with Viso Bhagava, Arahant. And also Buddha is an Arahant. Actually, I remember in Charyapitaka commentary, Charyapitaka commentary very clearly said that there is no difference between Buddha and Arahant by the Arahanthood. Of course, there can be other differences. There can be other differences, but there is no difference in Arahanthood. So in that sense, both Buddha and Buddha is an Arahant, Arahant are Arahants. Okay? Now, in Buddhism, a woman does not have a problem. Not only men, also women can become Arahant. But in Jainism, it is different. According to Jainism, a woman cannot become a Siddha. Okay? So ultimately, woman has to be born as a man in order to, you know. And then in Brahmanism, it's also very similar. I think I referred to it last week in my discussion. According to some Brahmanic traditions, they say that woman doesn't have to do anything else to go to heaven other than serving the husband. So, you know, which means that she doesn't need a religious life at all, actually. You know, she can be just at home and, you know, taking care of her husband, and, you know, that that is enough for her to go to heaven. So, you know, in different religions, you can see that, you know, in different manner, this has been looked at. It is for this reason that in many religions, women have been portrayed as the source of evil and sin, hence considered the main obstacle of men who try to follow the religion. The Christian story, so you already know. If the religious texts were authored by women, this would have been different. Feminist thinkers have tried to address this issue of male centricity prevalent in religion. Or they use the word male centricity, or also feminist thinkers have noticed that religious literature has been presented from male point of view. Okay, so the language itself is male oriented. Now, in some religious, I mean, feminist thinkers talk about what is called something called sex neutral. Sex neutral language. That means existing language is given always from the masculine point of view. For example, everything is written in he, not she. So the now there is a move to, I mean, for some time, some scholars have tried to develop some kind of sex neutral language. Of course, you know, such a language is used among our day-to-day English usage and usage in some other languages. But basically, they have tried to develop or pre-translate the religious texts like Bible in sex-neutral language. That means it doesn't refer to either man or woman. Okay? Because, I mean, there has been a lot of research going on in this direction, because male domination in religion has been very dominant and persistent factor, which is seen in religion, which is seen in religious literature, which is seen in religious practices, and you know everything. Now historically this has happened, but you know what is the justification of that? So now today's many societies seem to be thinking that, you know, there is no justification for that. But you know, I'm just try to bring into your attention you know, this particular aspect of religious literature. Now in Buddhism, as in all other religions, women have been kept in a lower position and are portrayed as weak, dishonest, and leading men astray. Some of these characterizations are due to the influence of the general Indian culture, which is found in Jataka literature. The other instances are due to the possibility that the existing discourses recorded by monks view women from a male soteriological point of view. It would, however, be interesting to know that the Buddha may have taught women, bhikkhunis and upasikas, and the instruction given to them. Since we do not have records of such sermons, we cannot know. It is imaginable, however, that the Buddha might have advised women, highlighting the negative aspects of men as he did with women. Now, you know, looking particularly from Buddhist point of view, looking at Buddhism, here I am asking you to look at several different points of view. One thing is to look at Buddhism, developments in Buddhism from historical point of view. The other thing is look at this problem from philosophical or position view of women point of view as a philosophical matter. How would have Buddha tackled this? Now, historical relationship means there are certain things Buddhism has got due to historical circumstances. Now, for example, in many Jataka stories, you find, you know, the lot of instances where women have been portrayed in a very negative manner. Now, of course, Jataka stories are presented as a past birth of the Buddha, but at the same time, we know these many Jataka stories are found in the general Indian literature. So we can imagine that lot of Jataka stories are the stories that come in from the general Indian society. So because general Indian society had this negative assessment of women, we can think that the Buddhism has also inherited some of these negative sentiments about women. Now this is one explanation. So understand the thing as not as really what Buddha said, but as more coming from historical position, because you know Buddhism is also Indian religion. The stories have been got into Buddhist tradition. Jataka stories, you know, develop gradually. So you have you know that general negative impression that is common to all Indian traditions. Okay. Now that is one way to look at this. The other way is will be to look at from a Dharma point of view, as I try to explain to you, philosophically, or from Dhamma. Now, in there we can talk about the male soteriological point of view and female soteriological point of view. Soteriology means, you know, the path, the attain the final goal, in Buddhist terms, attain Nirvana. So, how would you look at that from a philosophical point of view? Now, when we see the discrimination against women, we can see this as basically a historical phenomenon. And also we can see this as a social phenomenon. So this is how it goes. Now, all these are, you know, the like contextual things, where Buddhism arose, where any religion arose, these things you can see. But the important thing is, important question is, do we really have in Buddhism a situation where women are considered to be really psychologically or capacity-wise lower? You know, that is the important thing. Now, when we look at that, I think Buddhism has a clear answer for that question, because I think I highlighted this matter even before. You know, we have this Soma Theri's story. This comes in the Bhikkhuni Sanyutta. Now, here we have the Mara coming to Soma Theri and saying something like this.
යන්තං ඉසීහි පත්තබ්බං ථානං දුරභි සම්භවං න තං ද්වංගුල පඤ්ඤාය සක්කා පප්පෝතු මිත්‍යා.
Now this is what Mara says according to this sutta. Yantang isihi pattabbang thanang durabi sambhavang. Isihi pattabbang. It should be attained by great seers, great sages. Thanang durabi sambhavang. It is not very easy at all to attain. Natang dvangula panyaya. How can you with 2 inches knowledge? The woman's knowledge is, the traditional belief is like 2 inches long. For some reason or other, you know, they have this. This is a kind of derogatory statement with the 2 inches long. Sakka pappotu mithya. So the, how can woman attain a position that is usually attained by very high intelligent sages? A woman who has only 2 inches knowledge, how can a woman attain this? Now you know this is the, now you know this, the question has been put into the mouth of Mara. Okay? But then this is the general belief. People believe that women don't have much intelligence. Now as I told you, when women were deprived of education, you deprive somebody of education, then those people can't think. So naturally they look like foolish. But not because they are foolish really, but because they have been simply deprived of education. So the situation is this. Now this question comes from that background. How can women do these things? Women are simply doing household things like cooking and cleaning. Okay, how can women do this? So this is, you know, the Mara's question. So basically, yantang isihi pattabbang thanang durabi sambhavang. So this very difficult situation, how can a woman with very limited knowledge can attain? You know, this is the question. Now, look at her answer was itthi bhavo no kim kaira. Itthi bhavo no kim kaira chittam hi susamahite. ज्ञानम ही वर्तमानम ही सम्मा धम्मम विपस्सतो. नाउ यू नो लुक एट दिस क्वेश्चन इति भावो नो किं कायरा. Actually, that question can be translated into English as, what is wrong with being a woman? What is wrong with being a woman? Itti bhava no kin kaira. Itti bhava, being a woman, or womanness. What is the problem with being a woman? Chittam hi susamahite. If your mind is concentrated well. If your mind is concentrated well. Jnanam hi vattamanam hi, if you have knowledge. Jnanam hi vattamanam hi, knowledge exists. If your mind is well concentrated, if knowledge exists, to see samma dhammang vipassato, in order to see the phenomena in the insight knowledge. Samma dhammang vipassato. Vipassati means seeing something in a special manner, anicca dukkha anatta. Now, the look at this question. Actually, this question by Soma Theri sounds like a very feminist statement in a way, very modern. Okay, in some sense it is very modern, because she asked the question, what is wrong with being a woman? If your mind is good, if your knowledge is good, so what is the problem? Now, you know, the two most important things, chittam isu samahite, your emotional stability, your mind is concentrated. So that shows one aspect of human, you know, the spiritual development, internal development, your emotional stability, chittam isu samahite. And then the other one is jnanam, knowledge, epistemological aspect. Okay, so the knowledge and emotion, your knowledge is very good, your emotions are so stable. Chittam hi susamahite, mind is well controlled, emotionally stable, and then knowledge wise you have right knowledge in order to see the reality. So when you have these two things, what is the problem of being a woman? And then subsequently, ultimately, she says to Mara, yassa nuna siya evang ittiva purisotiva. Anyway, she says to Mara, to whomever, if it occurs that I am a man or I am a woman, that person deserves to be advised by the Mara. Now, what is it? If a person thinks that I am a man or I am a woman, that person needs to be or deserves to be advised by the Mara means that person has got completely wrong view. Now, wrong view is even if you think that you are a man or you are a woman. Now, ultimately, the Buddhist position is, our topic for this discussion is religion and women. Actually, according to Buddhism, both being a man and being a woman, you know, both these things have to be transcended. If you think that you are a low person because you are a woman, that is wrong. In the same manner, if somebody thinks that you are such a higher person because you are a man, that is also wrong. So on the one hand, here when we talk about religion, actual religion and the especially feminists try to show that, you know, the women are you know, capable of doing everything as men or even greater than men. Now, on the other hand, men basically think that, you know, other way around. But so according to Buddhism, actually these both ways, if a man feels pride, arrogant about being a man, if a woman feels down about being a woman, or if a woman feels that she is such a great, man feels he is so great, either way, any kind of thinking based on gender, whether you are a man or whether you are a woman, ultimately is not in accordance with Buddhism. Okay, now the Buddhist position is this. On the one hand, we are talking about the women have been kept subordinated to men. So men have been put in a higher position, women in a lower position. Then we are trying to put men and women both in an equal position. Okay. But ultimately, the idea is that both femininity and masculinity, both these ideas have to be given up. Okay? Now, the current situation is we have, in men we say masculinity and women we have femininity. I'm sorry, femininity. So masculinity and femininity, these two things. Actually, ultimate position according to Buddhism is you have to give up both, not one. Because for the, as Soma Theory's statement reveals, for the ultimate realization of Nirvana, whether you are a man or whether you are a woman doesn't really matter. If you really think about it, because why this has to be given up? Because ultimately, you know, this is based on I am man, or also I am woman. Now, either way, if you have this as I am a man or I am a woman, now you know what is this? Now, according to Buddhist analysis, this is actually what is called ahankara. Right? And then you have
mamankara.
What are these ahankara and mamankara? At what stage your ahankara will be gone in the path? Ahankara. Now, if you take sanyojana, sakkaya ditthi, vichikicca, silabbata paramasa, sakkaya ditthi. Sakkaya ditthi is actually, that is a sanyojana that goes at the level of sotapanna, right? So, ahankara and mamankara. Ahankara means I making. Mamankara means mind making. Mama means my. Ahang means I. So, so long as you make I, then you make mine. When you have I, then you have my. Now, Buddha says that both ahankara and mamankara are wrong. Whether you have ahankara and mamankara as a man, or whether you have ahankara and mamankara as woman, either way, this idea is wrong. So ultimately, the interesting thing is the Buddhist answer to this question, not really bringing the woman into the level of men. Okay? Ultimately, both men and women to give up their gender identities. Okay? So it is no longer man is looking as I am a man, or woman looking as I am a woman. So you know, you give up those things. Ultimately, when you become an arahant is not really, you can say, in his mind or her mind, neither man nor woman. Because your identity as man and man or woman is gone. Okay? Now, you know, that is a very high situation, high position, where you really renounce the concepts of ideas of both genders. Okay? So, now, looking at our discussion, religion and women, I wanted to do this discussion with you basically because the situation in religions as practiced today, we can see that there is a big difference between men and women. Okay? And also historically, when we look at the beginning of religions, also we can see that sort of thing. As I said, all religions have been started by men, and you know, the men have been the main people, and you know, so on and so forth. But when we really look at this phenomenon throughout the history, we can see how these, you know, the, through different religions, this discrimination against women and subordination of women have been continued. But you know, in Buddhism, started again 6th century BCE, Buddha established something very important, namely that there is no intellectual difference between men and women. Up to that point, women were considered to be less intelligent than men. Now, historical social reason behind that is when women are not given education, they look like less intelligent anyway. But of course, if you're given education, then you will see that there is no difference between basically men and women in that sense. So, you know, one thing remarkable in the Buddhist tradition is to establish that men and women are intellectually similar. But that doesn't mean that there were no discriminations. Actually, there were in the when the tradition was existing. You know, there were, you know, the certain things. Now, if you look at Attagarudharma is very interesting. Attagarudharma keeps women under the bhikkhus. Bhikkhunis under the bhikkhus. Now, you remember in my discussion on Jainism, I showed you in Jainism, Samanis are lower than the Samanas. And not only that, it's very clearly said that a Samani who is even 120 years old has to pay respect to the Samana who is entered in that day. Now in Attagarudharma, you have the same thing. In fact, the story says that when Mahapajapati Gotami asked Venerable Ananda to change that, Venerable Ananda went to the Buddha and said that she wants to change this. Then Buddha says that, how can I do this? Even other religious people don't do it, Buddha says. Now, who are these other religious people? I think Jainism. Because there is no any other religious tradition with summoners during the time of the Buddha. Of course, they have a Ajivaka Paribhajaka, but if you look at the organized religious tradition, the closest one was Jaina. And in the Jaina tradition, you see that Jaina in the Vinaya, it says very clearly that Bhikkhuni is under. Same thing, exactly the same way is said in the Jainism. And it's said in Buddhism also. Now you can see this, these are social things. Why Buddha could not change it? Maybe because, you know, that was the tradition during that time. But at least Buddhism has shown that there is no difference between men and women intellectually. So in that sense, you can see that in the Attagaru Dhamma, accepting certain things, Buddhism could not go beyond Jainism. But Buddhism certainly went beyond Jainism when Buddhism showed that equally both men and women can become arahants and, you know, terminate the samsaric suffering. Okay, folks, let me wind up by discussion. Basically, when we were discussing religion and women, the reason for this discussion was when you look at the status of women in religions. As I tried to tell you at the beginning of today's discussion, on one hand, we can say that why we do need to discuss women separately. There is no need, actually, but the need comes from, because religion has been one institute where, you know, this gender difference has been maintained for a long time. In other words, on the basis of religion, gender differences are justified. Now again, in Jainism, it is very clear. In Jainism, women do good things in order to become men. And those men who become bad things, they become women in the next life, according to Jainism. Now, similar beliefs are even among the Buddhist society. But I don't think Buddhism, the Buddha has justified that kind of position. Okay? But then there are general beliefs. To be born in as a woman is not a good thing. I mean, those things come from society, because if you look at the society, you can see that woman's life has been very miserable. Then you gradually start thinking that to be born as a woman is as a result of bad karma. So, you know, all these historical, social reasons have been intertwined, and then finally, you know, this type of belief has evolved in the society. So I tried to show you across world religions how world religions treat women. And then also I showed you that, you know, when you look at the subordination of women, all world religions seem to be subordinating women to men. But then there are certain things. So Buddhism, in a sense, is not completely free from all these things. But at least in Buddhism, we can see that Buddha has shown something very important, namely intellectually and psychologically, you know, like emotionally, women can be equally or even better stated. Finally, let me remind you another incident, like we saw that in the Roman Catholic tradition and other traditions, women are not supposed to teach or preach. Now, again, there is a very interesting example in Dhammadinna. Dhammadinna was, you know, teaching Dhamma to her former husband. And then when he kind of could not believe it, so he goes to the Buddha and reports, you know, these are the questions I asked and these are the questions she answered, gave me as answers. Then what the Buddha says? Buddha says that if you ask these questions from me, I would have given the same answers. Now, that's placing Bhikkhuni Dhammadinna equal to the Buddha, very high position. Buddha says, I will give the same answers, like, you know. Now, in fact, you don't find similar incident anywhere in any religion. Anywhere in any religion, no. Because the teacher, religious teacher, saying that is exactly what I would say. So in Buddhism, actually, there was no prohibition for women to teach. Bhikkhunis have been teachers. Bhikkhunis have been meditation teachers. Bhikkhunis have been teaching Dhamma. So, you know, that sense we can see that in certain respects, in this overall picture, Buddhism stands out, okay? That we don't need to believe because we are Buddhist. But when we look at objectively, we can see that in certain respects, you know, the women have been very much higher in the Buddhist tradition. But organizationally, we can see that, you know, there are differences. There are historical differences. So those things we will have to analyze in a different manner. Okay, this is basic summary of that. I will wind up from this. What I would like to do tomorrow is actually morning session. I will be summarizing both world religions and ethics, the main things we did tomorrow morning. Okay, do you have any questions or comments? Women, not that women cannot be religious teacher, but in the history we don't have religious teachers. That doesn't mean that if a woman can, anybody can start a religion, now you can start really. So it's no problem. But in the history, we don't see religious teachers. Now, of course, you know, that's a historical thing. Why in different traditions there were no religious teachers? Because in the ancient world, it was basically male-dominated society. Men were the people who had the education, who had the thinking ability. You know, that is why. So it is a historical thing. It doesn't mean that woman cannot be a religious teacher. It doesn't mean that. What I said is that women were not religious teachers. There were no women religious teachers. That's a historical thing. Not really human right or anything, somebody prevented it or nothing like that. Simply because the historical situation in the ancient world is such that, you know, women were kept under. So, you know, they didn't come up with any kind of innovative ideas. But today it is different, right? In the world, women are lecturers, professors, leaders, prime ministers, presidents, and, you know, all these things. So, you know, it's different now. Yes, yes. Finally, question from a woman. Okay, go ahead. In China, what is happening? Say it again, in China. Okay, thank you. Actually, in China, in Southeast Asia, China, Japan, and Korea, the main ideology is Confucianism. Okay? So society is Confucian. In the Confucian society, women are very, very behind the men and, you know, very subdued. So what you see in China, not really Buddhism, really. What you see in all these the cultures is basically Confucian culture. Even though mainland China was under communism, Confucian thinking is very strong even today. Now, you know, that is common for Japan, that is even more common for country like Korea. That's why, you know, in Japanese culture you see always, you know, when women talking or laughing, they do like this, because they are not supposed to be laughing with open mouth. So, you know, every time they do like this. Now, that comes from Confucianism. They are not supposed to talk loud. They are not supposed to talk, retort when your father or when your brother or when your husband is talking. Now, all these things are basically Confucian ethics, okay? So, in Chinese society, that's a good question. Chinese society, you have this Confucian influence very, very high, okay? Now, of course, what the Buddhist tradition did was reduce these conditions. Now, India, the same thing with the Brahmins, but, you know, under Buddhist tradition, it was the society was created with, you know, women could flourish, but, you know, that's within very limits, you know, within Buddhist tradition only, because today you can see that India has not changed much because of Buddhism. Ultimately, Buddhism disappeared from India, so India is the same old India even today. right? But if you take countries like, say, Myanmar, like, or even Sri Lanka, I mean, you take Myanmar, actually situation of women in Myanmar in many sense, you know, like better than, you know, Islamic countries and better than some of the Western countries. And in the Western countries, you know, they were struggling to get inheritance and these things. In the Burmese society, women can own things. Women have their own inheritance. So you can see, in some sense, in the Buddhist societies, women were better off. But that doesn't mean, again, women were really, like, you know, completely free or something. No, they always were a little below. Particularly in the Myanmar also, if you look at the public positions, all held by men, not women. But on the other hand, woman is a powerful person in the family. Man is also below woman in the family. So, you know, woman has a domain where woman can be very, in the Buddhist tradition. Okay, so, you know, it depends on, like in China, of course, I would consider, because even the authoritative Marxist rule could not change China. Because after Mao Zedong and after you know, the relaxing the situation, it is very Confucian today. You can see that, you see. So I remember, you know, the, when Mao Zedong was alive, there was a very, very huge, you know, the campaign against Confucius. When I first saw, as a small, you know, the, like, you know, 15, 16 years old, long time ago, I thought this Confucius must be some political leader who is living now. That's why they are fighting against. But to see that Confucius lived 6th century BCE, but in their writings, Mao Zedong, you know, the referring to Confucius as the enemy. So I thought this enemy must be still living. But to see that he was this very ancient Confucius, really. So China, Japan, Korea, these countries have to be, the situation has to be understood with reference to Confucianism much more than anything else, okay?
Yes. Go ahead. There are a few Sarakas headed over the way to say Antigua. And you put two reasons. One of the reasons is the Buddha's meaning to talk about headed over the way. Another thing is the economics of the cause. The economics of the cause.
Okay.
About that. So how can you say that?
To answering your question, first question, why we don't have what the Buddha taught to bhikkhunis, and I suggested that we don't have a sanghayana conducted by bhikkhunis, okay? Now, we know that the first sanghayana bhikkhunis were not included. It was done by only by the arahant monks, okay, bhikkhus. Now, my idea comes from, when you look at the bhikkhunis asana, like Buddha taught to bhikkhus, Buddha must have taught so much to the bhikkhunis. Okay? Now, the why those things are not mentioned? Particularly when you look at, because when you look at from the Dhamma, many things are said from the point of view of Dhamma, I mean the bhikkhuni, I'm sorry, point of view of the bhikkhu. Okay? Now, what about the similar things? Like my example from Mahaparinibbana Sutta, Buddha, Venerable Ananda asks, how should we behave towards women? Buddha says, don't look at them. Okay. But then what about the women? What about the bhikkhunis? Don't they have the same problem? I mean, if they ask, how should we behave towards bhikkhus, then what would the Buddha say? Buddha could have said the same thing, don't look at them, don't talk to them, you know, something like that. So my actually observation is only what I think, because simply because we don't have so much recorded things about the bhikkhunis, I think some of those things about bhikkhunis were not recorded. And then if they had their own sanghayana, perhaps we can think that they would have had, you know, something to say about them. Okay, so what I said is basically historically what I think to be the case. Okay, but I can't prove it. I can't say really no. The Buddha really said these things to bhikkhunis, but you know, nobody recorded or anything. But simply because, you know, we don't have, bhikkhunis were underrepresented. They were not represented. You know, so it's natural that many things Buddha said to bhikkhunis were not recorded. Okay, so the point is, like, when somebody looks from outside, you can always see that Buddha is talking in terms of bhikkhus, in terms of men and women to be the bad people. But women are bad in the sense, bad for the liberation of men. Okay, but men can be bad for the liberation of women, isn't it? So it goes both ways. Now, what we find in the Dhamma is only the bhikkhu's point of view. You know, that is why I think, you know, there must have been some literature, but nothing recorded. Okay. Number two, actually the bhikkhuni sasana, establishing bhikkhuni sasana is a problem in all Theravada countries, including Sri Lanka. But then in Sri Lanka, what happened was, about 15-20 years ago, I think 1986, they established a bhikkhuni sasana, but that is a combination of Mahayana and Theravada. Because initially they got Upasampada from Mahayana, and then they got again Upasampada from Theravada monks. So initial thing is not 100% Theravada. It is 50% Mahayana, 50% Theravada, okay? Now, ever since, those nuns, bhikkhunis, have been given the bhikkhuni ordination, so gradually it is becoming Theravada, okay? But the initially you can say it is Mahayana and Theravada, both. So there is a venerable traditional argument. Traditional argument is the monks, bhikkhus, say that in order to establish bhikkhuni sasana, there must be the Buddha. So in the absence of Buddha, you can't establish bhikkhuni sasana. So that is the standard, you know, the argument. I think that argument is a strong argument. But I think if the Theravada tradition want to establish bhikkhuni sasana, all the leading monks can get together and agree to do that. They can do that. But monks will not agree. But if you look at the history, it's very interesting. In the first Sanghayana, after the Sanghayana, the Sangha came up with several charges, complaints against Venerable Ananda. One of the complaints was that Venerable Ananda persuaded the Buddha to give Upasampada to bhikkhunis. So you can see, starting from the first Sanghayana, Theravada tradition did not like bhikkhuni sasana. Okay. So it is not something new. It is not something new. So in the Theravada tradition, starting from the after the Parinirvana, bhikkhus didn't like the idea. So it is no wonder. So one thing is, I respect the modern, the leading Sangha, because they are real good Theravadins. They still don't like it. Anyhow, this is a historical thing. I think now, for example, in Sri Lanka, they started as I said, Mahayana and Theravada. But you know, interesting thing is, when you say Mahayana, although Mahayana Dharma is different, Mahayana Vinaya is actually Hinayana Vinaya. There is no separate Vinaya called Mahayana Vinaya. Now, even today, Mahayana traditions follow Dharmaguptika Vinaya. Now, if you look at Dharmaguptika Vinaya and Theravada Vinaya, Parajikas are the same, Sanghadisesas are the same, only differences are Aniyata, Pachittiya and these things. So the Vinaya is nothing Mahayana. Vinaya has been always Hinayana. Now, Theravada is also considered to be one Hinayana thing. So, even though the tradition is Mahayana tradition, Vinaya is very Hinayana. So, anyhow, that is how Sri Lanka started. But now, you know, that tradition in Sri Lanka, there are about, I think, several thousand bhikkhunis in Sri Lanka. Now, they are doing okay. And then, but still the government and the Mahanayaka Thera Sangha, doesn't accept it. But ordinary Sangha accept it. They invite bhikkhunis for Dhamma sermons and, you know, so a lot of things are happening. But anyway, that is, don't take the bad example from Sri Lanka, so. Okay, any other questions? Okay, Venerable, so yeah, thank you very much for participating. So we will meet again tomorrow morning to discuss both religion and ethics and, you know, to complete our discussions. Okay, thank you very much.